Okay, welcome back. We're going to try to make the audio work this time. The lesson this day is magnetic forces. So actually, it's going to be pretty quick. I want to talk about something you already know about. That's the notion of an electric field. The idea of an electric field is you have a charge of some kind. I'll call it Q sub s, the source charge. And it's going to produce a force acting on some other charge, maybe the target charge. And in order to compute that, the first thing we need to do is to calculate the electric field produced by the source charge. That's a familiar formula. It involves r hat, which is a unit vector that points from the source charge to the target charge. And you simply compute the electric field using the Coulomb's law formula from a point charge. And then to get the force on the target charge, you multiply the target charge by the electric field produced by the source charge. So you end up with a force in this case that's in the opposite direction of the electric field, since the target charge happens to be negative. So that's just a reminder of how that went. Now the magnetic field is similar, but subtly different. So for example, there is still a magnetic force, there is still a source charge, but this time you have to take into account the motion of the source charge. So the source charge is moving with some velocity, V sub s, the velocity of the source charge, and the target charge is now going to experience a force only if it is also moving. The magnetic field produced by the moving source charge depends on the velocity of the source charge and, again, on the r hat vector. But there's a cross product in there, V source cross r hat, which produces a field vector which is perpendicular to the plane of r hat and V sub s. In this case, using the right-hand rule, you can see that the magnetic field produced by this positive charge moving up and to the right points into the board at the location of the target charge. Now, what force gets produced? To answer that question, you need to use the force law, Q times V cross B, and you need to take into account the velocity of the target charge. Notice that the magnetic force is such that moving charges produce a field which acts on other moving charges. Both the source charge and the target charge have to be moving in order for this force to happen. Okay, so another point is that V cross B in this case points up and to the right, but because it's a negative target charge, the force points down and to the left. Okay, so that's all there is to that. Let's look at an example. So here we have an experiment that we did in the lab the other day. We have a filament that's perpendicular to the board with current that gets it hot. And there's a potential difference between the filament and the sort of circular cross-section. It's a cylindrical can that's held at some positive potential relative to the filament. That accelerates electrons out of the can. There's a little hole in the can where they come out and acquire some velocity downward in this case. And in the presence of the magnetic field, you compute the force as the charge on the electron minus the elementary charge times V cross B. V cross B points to the left in this picture, but because it's a negatively charged electron, the force ends up pointing to the right. The electron accelerates out of the can and it moves in a circular trajectory in the uniform magnetic field. The circular trajectory arises from the fact that the velocity and the force are always perpendicular to one another, and the force only depends on the velocity. Since the force is perpendicular, it doesn't do any work. The velocity remains constant in magnitude. The speed is constant, and so that means the force remains constant in magnitude but always perpendicular to the velocity vector, and that results in circular motion. The radius of curvature of the circle is determined by the magnetic field strength, the charge on the moving object, the moving charge carrier in this case. It also depends on the mass and the velocity. So let's actually work that out. So the idea is we have the momentum principle. The momentum principle says that the rate of change of the momentum is equal to the net force. In this case, the parallel component of the rate of change of momentum is zero. And that's simply because the force is perpendicular to the momentum, so the momentum is only changing in a direction perpendicular to the momentum. So we can forget about the parallel component. We can only address the perpendicular component. And As you recall, if the particle is non-relativistic, which it is highly non-relativistic in this example, the perpendicular component of the rate of change of momentum is mv squared over r. The magnitude of the magnetic force is just qvb because v and b are perpendicular to one another. We can solve this by moving the mv, canceling out of v, moving the q downstairs, and you get that b is equal to mv divided by q times r. Another thing we need to do is to figure out that velocity. We don't actually measure the velocity of these guys. They're moving quite rapidly. We don't have any easy way to do it. But we do know the potential difference through which they're accelerated at the beginning. And we know the energy principle. The energy principle claims that the change in the kinetic energy plus the change in the potential energy should be zero, since there are no outside forces doing work. There are no surroundings acting on the thing in this case. And that means that the change in the kinetic energy, being positive, must be balanced by the change in the potential energy, the electron falling through a potential difference between the filament and the can. We can use that information to solve for the speed of the electron, and then use that information to combine with the magnetic field expression that we have there to get an expression that involves the stuff we know, the potential, the charge, the radius of curvature, and the magnetic field, and the thing we don't know. In this case, we were pretending like we didn't know the mass of the electron, and we fit a graph of magnetic field versus the square root of 2v over q times 1 over r to a straight line. And the slope of that straight line we computed, we squared it, and compared it to the mass of the electron. It turned out to be correct within about 4%. So, there you have it. There are some subtleties which I'll remind you. The magnetic field we actually knew wasn't the total magnetic field. The net magnetic field is what shows up in this formula. But we only had the magnetic field due to the coils in the laboratory. The Earth's magnetic field was unknown, but it worked out to be the intercept of this graph because B is equal to the Earth's magnetic field plus the coil magnetic field. And so the intercept was negative, and it was equal to the magnitude of the Earth's magnetic field. Really nice experiment. I want to do a couple of other examples related to moving conductors in a magnetic field. And I wanted to just describe for you sort of what happens. So if you have a conducting bar, say of length L, moving in a magnetic field pointing into the board, you know that the force on the charge carriers in the bar is going to be QV cross B. Now, if they're positive charge carriers, they'll be forced up. If they're negative charge carriers, they'll be forced down. Either way, you'll end up with negative charges accumulating at the bottom of the bar and positive charges accumulating at the top of the bar. That accumulated charge is going to produce a polarization field, a field due to the polarization of the bar that's going to point downward. And in either case, whether the charge carriers are positive or whether the charge carriers are negative, that electric field is going to oppose the force from the magnetic field. And you'll continue this process until the thing reaches equilibrium. In other words, you'll continue until the polarization field multiplied by Q is the same as the magnetic field force, the QV cross B force from the magnetic field, so that when you add those two guys together, you end up with zero. You'll notice that QVB would have to then be equal to QE, those being the magnitudes of the two forces, and since the Qs are the same, you get that the electric field depends only on the speed of the bar and the magnetic field strength. It is independent of the sign of the charge carrier, which is kind of neat. We can use that to answer a question. What happens if we put a bar like that across a couple of rails in a magnetic field and then connect a resistor between the two rails? If you follow along, you'll see that the rails become polarized. The current that flows in the bar then also flows through the resistor, and the resistor dissipates energy. There's an electric field in the bar, there's an electric field in the resistor, and there's an electric field in the rails. So you end up with this loop electric field situation. Now we know that the sum of the E dot delta L's around the loop has to be zero, and that implies that there's got to be an EMF in the bar. The EMF in the bar is going to end up being simply the polarization field. Well, the change in potential across the bar is the polarization field times the length of the bar. Now, that's essentially going to be the same as the EMF, except that the EMF is what pushes the charges out of the positive part of the bar and back to the negative part of the bar. Actually, it's what pushes the charges from the bottom of the bar to the top of the bar. It's the EMF of the magnetic field. The current is going to end up being the EMF divided by the resistance in the resistor, neglecting the small voltage drops in the rails, and so we get VBL divided by R. The electrical power, then, is our old friend, the change in potential across the resistor times the current through the resistor. So you simply multiply again by delta V, and you get VBL squared over R. Now, I'd like to work out the mechanical power. The mechanical power is how much work you have to do to actually push this bar. Now, the point is, there's going to be a current in the bar, and the magnetic force acting on the bar is going to point a little bit to the left. In other words, there's going to be a force on the charge carriers that points sort of up and to the left, and there's going to be an X component and a Y component to that force. The X component is going to push the bar to the left, opposing in the opposite direction of the velocity, and you're going to have to overcome that force in order to keep the bar moving. And so, just roughly, you've got a current flowing in the bar. You've got to apply a force. If you take I L cross B, you get a force from the magnetic field pointing to the left, and you've got to apply a force that overcomes that. It's going to have to be equal and opposite to the force from the magnetic field acting on the bar itself, and that's going to have to be ILB. Okay? The work that you do in moving the bar a short distance is force dotted into displacement. The force is ILB in magnitude, the displacement is delta X in magnitude, and so to move the bar a distance delta X to the right, you've got to do an amount of work equal to ILB delta X. Taking the rate of work is dividing delta W by delta T, and you'll notice you end up with delta X divided by delta T. But what is delta X divided by delta T? It's nothing other than our friend, the speed, right? So we get ILB times the speed, which turns out to be nothing other than VLB squared over R. The punchline is that the mechanical work required to move the bar to the right is equal to the power dissipated in the resistor. So the energy that goes in turns out to be completely lost, dissipated in the form of heat primarily in the resistance, but it works out to be exactly the same. So that's very satisfying. All right, that's it for today. We'll see you guys next time.